I want you to have a big picture. That's my goal. By the time we get done with this introduction, that you have a big picture that, you know, I see this world differently. I see myself differently. Everything that we're doing occurs in the domain of mind. And in the domain of mind, what you believe is the whole thing. It's like in the domain of material, you know, muscle energy is what moves things. In the domain of mind, what you believe and what you're aware of is what moves things. And so necessarily, we all have to be on the same page, and we're going to spend a little time to get there. How many of you would like to use NMT to diagnose and treat any disease that a client might present to you? Everyone? Everyone. Well, you know, we were off to such a great start. I'm sorry. You can't diagnose anything with NMT. And the truth is, you can't treat anything with NMT. You can't. So, I apologize. I wish, I should have emailed you guys so you could make an early cancellation. There's a reason that I say that. There's way too much consideration of disease and not enough consideration of healing in this world. And to be honest, to diagnose disease, there's a certain criteria that's involved. You collect data, you do tests, you make observations, you correlate that data, and you match it with diagnostic criteria. So, you know, it's kind of like a checklist. You know, if you meet, you know, 80% of the checklist, then you meet this diagnosis. What do you do with the diagnosis? Well, you take that diagnosis and you go to the PDR and you make a decision on which of the various pharmaceuticals that need to be given for that particular diagnosis. That's the system of allopathic medicine. Or you determine that a particular surgery is appropriate, etc. You do some physical level intervention that interrupts, forcefully interrupts body processes. Our view in NMT is that there's always an informational basis to disease and to the failure to heal. And that informational basis is a confusion. The mind-body sees itself, it sees the challenges it has to face, and it sees the resources it has to address those challenges in a way that causes it to fail to make the very best choices that it could possibly make. If that's not true, if the mind-body already sees itself perfectly accurately, if it already sees the challenges it has to respond to maintain its internal balance, its homeostasis required to be able to live accurately, and if it already has a perfect understanding of the resources available to address those challenges, then there's really nothing that we can do in NMT. But that's never the case. It's never the case. There's always a potential to heal that is lying latent. There is an innate intelligence in the body. There's an intelligence in every single cell. Every single cell actually has a life of its own. You know, there are cells that were taken 40 years ago out of a woman with ovarian cancer, and they're still used in cell cultures. Every one of them is alive. It would be possible today to manipulate the environment of any one of those cells in a way that made it an omnipotential cell and create a whole new person that was a clone of that original person. Each of us has something like 50 trillion cells. Each of those cells is doing something like 3,000 or 4,000 chemical operations per second. You do the math on that, and you'll see you have a big management problem. A big management problem. And it's not so much a surprise that we get ill or we fail to heal. It's a surprise, really, that we do so well. It's fantastic. It's unbelievable under the circumstances. So we're going to be looking at this issue of innate intelligence, where it comes from, how it's distributed through the mind-body, and how we can access deficiencies within the implementation of that innate intelligence. This is what guides our growth, maturation, and healing. So disease has an informational basis. And disease really comes from the inside out, just like health. Disease isn't so much a condition that afflicts us or pounces on us like a cat from a tree, but it's something that arises from inside of us. In chiropractic, we sometimes use the hyphenated form of the word dis-ease, which I think is an interesting term. If we externalize this process, if we see disease as something that comes from outside of us, we relinquish the power that we have to heal ourselves. And it's important that we have an accurate understanding of how disease and health proceed. Many of you, I'm sure, are familiar with Wayne Dyer, a psychologist and a presenter in personal development. He uses a term. He says, when we change the way we look at things, the things we look at change. And that's really one of the most profound statements in the world. I think he borrowed it, to be honest. I've seen it other places, but it is nonetheless true. When we change the way we look at things, the things we look at change. And you're going to see that this is not just a kind of a metaphorical statement. This is literally true, that everything in the world, everything in the universe, is a product of the way we look outward. Disease and wellness are two sides of the same coin. How the mind-body sees itself, the physical reality that flows from that vision. This is a terrific book. Liza is an MD, and she's written this book, Mind Over Medicine, which is a wonderful book about what's often called placebo effect. And we're going to be talking about placebo effect. You ever hear somebody say, oh, that's just placebo? You know, it's like you're walking along the street and you see something shiny and you bend, oh, it's just a diamond. What? It's just placebo. So I want to start with this story because this is the best placebo you have ever heard of. So this case occurred in 1957. 1957, for those of you that weren't around, there are a couple that were. Many that weren't, I can see, as we look around the room, there was a new cancer drug, right? And new cancer drugs typically come out with a big fanfare and drumbeat, and this one was called Crebiozin. And so this is a study by Dr. Bruno Kofler, and he's the fellow that came up with the Rorschach's inkblot test. You know the Rorschach's test where you look at this nebulous kind of thing that looks like an ink blot, and you tell your psychiatrist or psychologist what that reminds you of. So he reports a story of a Dr. Philip West and his patient, Mr. Wright. Dr. West was treating Mr. Wright, who had developed advanced cancer, lymphosarcoma, and all the treatments had failed. And this was stage four. This guy was in really, really bad shape. His neck, chest, abdomen, armpits, groin, they were all filled with tumors the size of oranges. And his spleen and liver were enlarged. His cancer had caused his chest to fill with up to 2 quarts of water. This was a guy who was right on the edge of passing over. And Dr. West didn't expect that this guy was going to live for another week. That's the stage that he was at. But this fellow wanted desperately to live, and his hope hung on this new drug, Crebiozin. You know, some people are true believers. you know, and you can hear it in their voice. They talk about they, which is with a capital T, they are going to have a new drug for fill in the blank. And they just, you know, they're just true believers. Well, I think Mr. Wright may have been one of those people. So he begged his doctor to treat him with this Crebiazin. And it was only offered to people who were in, had a reasonable prospect of benefiting from the drug. And this fellow was way beyond that. So he was too sick to qualify. He was begging his doctor to treat him with the Crebiazin. And so what Dr. West did is he gave in and he injected him. And West performed the procedure on a Friday. But deep down, he didn't believe that Wright was even going to last the weekend. So to his shock, on Monday, 3 days later, Dr. West found his patient walking around out of bed. According to Dr. Knopfler, Mr. Wright's tumor masses had melted like snowballs on a hot stove 3 days later and were half their original size. 10 days after the first dose of Crebiazin, Mr. Wright left the hospital apparently cancer-free. Mr. Crebiazin was rocking and rolling, praising Crebiazin as a miracle drug for 2 months until scientific literature began reporting that Crebiazin didn't seem to be effective. At that point, Mr. Wright, who trusted that what he read in the literature, fell back into a deep depression, his cancer came back. That's not the end of the story. This time, Dr. West, who really wanted to help this guy, decided to get sneaky. So he told Mr. Crebiazin that he had some initial supplies of the drug that had deteriorated during shipping. Probably that's what Mr. Wright had received. But he had a special stash of the really good high concentrate Crebiazin. And he was going to give that to him. So he injected him. But he didn't inject him with, because he didn't have a stash. He had saline water, and that's what he injected him with. So again, Mr. Wright's tumors melted away. The fluid in the chest disappeared. He was feeling great for another 2 months. And that's not the end of the story. Because at the end of 2 months, the American Medical Association announced that the study of Crebiazin was being terminated because it was ineffective. At that point, all of the tumors came back, and the man died 2 days later. Deepak Chopra tells a similar story. He tells a story about a woman who came to his office. I believe it was stage 4 ovarian cancer. Chopra, you're all familiar with, I'm sure, author, Ayurvedic medicine specialist, MD. And he began working with his system of Ayurvedic medicine, exercise, nutrition, philosophy. And all of the tumors in that are shown up on imaging in this woman's chest and abdomen disappeared. They're gone. And so she goes back to her oncologist. And she was so excited. She wanted to share this good news with her oncologist. And the oncologist just looks at her and he says, "Honey, don't be naive. You're going to die. This stage 4 cancer, this doesn't go away. You're going to die. You know, get yourself in order. Be reasonable. Don't listen to this nonsense. You know, die with some dignity." And that's exactly what she did. She went home and the tumors returned and she died. What happened? How did this saline water for Mr. Wright cause these tumors to disappear more miraculously? You've never heard of any cancer drug doing what the distilled water did. Well, of course, it wasn't the distilled water. What it was is simply that the mind-body had an opportunity to reconsider its condition, to reconsider the challenges it faced, and to reconsider the resources it had to respond to those challenges. That's exactly what happened. And it happened to happen, it happened to occur as the result of this event of being injected. And the event of being injected, coupled with the belief system of Mr. Wright, who was, as I say, he must have been a true believer. This doesn't happen to everybody that gets injected with saline water, but for him, it did. For other people, it'll take something different to trigger that. But what was triggered was this new awareness, and with this new awareness, more effective choices could be made, physiological choices in the body, and that's precisely what happened, and it's all that happened. That's it. That's it. And what we're going to learn is how to do that effectively. How could we dialogue with the body to cause it to recognize efficiently and quickly the deficiencies in awareness and understanding that are keeping it from healing to its best capacity? And that's the long and short of what we're going to be doing this weekend. And this is what placebo is. You know, you might ask somebody what a placebo is, and they'd say it's a sugar pill. Or they'd tell you some other particular thing. But what I'll tell you a placebo is this. A placebo is any event that causes the mind-body to recognize the deficiencies in its awareness of itself, the challenges it faces, and the resources it has to respond to those challenges. There's a mechanism within the body that's committed and dedicated to doing precisely that. And it's, if you put your fingers like this and like this, those two lines that you've described are going to intersect right in that magic place in the middle of the head called the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. From here on, known as the HPA axis, just for obvious reasons. It's a lot easier. And here's what's so magical about the HPA axis. The hypothalamus is right in the center of the brain. And it's considered to be brain tissue, but it's also considered to be a gland. It's connected by way of a stalk of tissue to the pituitary gland. And the pituitary gland has two parts, an anterior and a posterior part, and the anterior part creates what are called releasing factors. They're hormones themselves, but they're hormones that go to and activate hormonal tissues to tell them to make the other hormones that the body needs. And the reason this is so important is that hormones are the chemical emails. They're the chemical emails that the body sends. You know, hopefully no spam. But they're the emails, the chemical emails that the body sends that tell each cell of those 50 trillion cells what they need to be doing so that all 50 trillion cells can work together to make you. And without that, the mind-body gets disorganized, cells begin doing things, tissues begin doing things that are out of time and out of coordination with the needs of the whole body. So what happens? Well, anything can happen. Tumors can arise. Would a tumor arise if the whole of the mind-body understood its condition and relationship to one another? Of course not. So it's all about communication. It's all about information. And the interesting thing about the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis is that it receives information from the sensory centers in the brain. So it gets all that data coming in from touch, taste, smell, vision. It gets information from the thinking centers, the cerebral cortex. It gets information from the emotional centers. You know, there are spiritual centers in the brain. It gets information from those centers. So all of the information that's relevant to our lives is processed by the hypothalamus. And decisions are made by the correlation of all of that information. Based upon those decisions, the hypothalamus makes its releasing factors, these special hormones that are sent out to the body and cause other tissues to do their work. This stalk of tissue, this stalk of neurological tissue that goes to the anterior pituitary, that stalk of tissue then sends signals and also sends chemistries that tell the pituitary, the master gland, if you will, how much work the adrenals should be doing, how much work other tissues like the thyroid and other glands should be doing. So there's this continuous feedback at the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis correlating all of this information. And so this is where it all happens. This is where it all happens. And the result of the change in awareness from the injection of the saline water for Mr. Wright, both the result of the work by Dr. Chopra and the misdeed of the oncologist who unfortunately told the woman that she was going to die, all had the effect they had because they had an effect here. They had an effect based upon the belief and the awareness that the mind-body held at that moment. And the physiology that ensued from that was a result of that belief and that awareness. In healing, you know who this fellow is? Do you recognize him? John of God. He's from Brazil, and he's probably one of the most famous healers in the world. People travel. I know a number of people that have gone there to see him. He does remote work. He's in a pretty remote area, actually, of Brazil, and has a compound there, and people come to see him. Set and setting is very important. What you believe as you're doing healing and what the person that you're working with believes are critical. It's all about belief. It's all about awareness. And set and setting can have a lot to do with that. So does this look like a set and setting that would be impressive? It does, doesn't it? I mean, there are statues that are part of the, Catholic iconography. There are acolytes sitting. Everybody's dressed in white. It's a beautiful setting. It's a beautiful setting. And it looks as though that's something that might support the belief system, is it not, of somebody who is to be healed. Here's a woman who's being treated. I believe that these are Vogel crystals. And there's a whole theory about that. My belief about these kinds of things is that this is all happening in mind. It's all about information. And my personal belief is that the thing is less important than the belief about it. So, conclusions. Latent in the hypothalamus, latent in the pituitary, are chemical messengers capable of nearly immediate physical tissue transformation. Entrainment to beliefs of what is possible and what is not possible limit the expression of this innate healing potential. And successful access to these limiting mental images and attunement, awareness and attunement to those limiting images can produce a release of the innate potential to heal, and we can have miraculous transformations. And that's what this weekend is going to be about. So, intention, it's always a part of any healing modality. Any healing modality. There are three components of any type of energy medicine protocol, and they are the belief, or at least the provisional belief. You know what I mean when I say provisional belief? You're not committed, but, I'll hold on to that belief until proven otherwise. We'll see how it works. The belief of the practitioner in their method. There was a fellow who's a chiropractor. I mentioned that because, I can use the C word in that way, because I am one and have been for a long time. But an unfortunate thing happens in chiropractic colleges, at least one, maybe more. And that is, even though our profession began based upon the idea of this innate intelligence and blockages to innate intelligence, that whole concept is not even taught in chiropractic college, and many chiropractic college students have never even heard the word, never even heard the term. I presented to some at a meeting prior to one of my seminars a couple of years ago, and one of the questions I asked is, so did they teach you guys about innate intelligence? And one of the fellows raised his hands and he said, well, we've heard the term, but we don't really know what it means. I mean, you could have knocked me over with a feather. It's just like, wow. So it is the basis of our work. And so this fellow that I was referring to that had come to a seminar, not the student, but a seasoned chiropractor, a number of years ago, sat in the back of the room, kind of had his arms folded like this. The whole seminar, he's kind of looking at me like, you know, I was trying to sell him a used car. And so I talked to him at the end of the seminar, and he said, well, you know, I'm going to take this home and see how it works. And in my mind, I'm thinking, you're going to see how it works? What, you're going to flip a switch and stand back and you know, and see if it lights up or what? So that was his idea. And so we have a forum, a web forum, where you can ask questions and I can answer and other experienced practitioners can answer and we can dialogue on things to help your practice and help your patients, your clients. And so he wrote, he said, you know, I don't think this NMT works. He says, I've seen this. He says, this isn't the first energetic medicine seminar I've been to a number of them, and you know what happens is it works for a while and then it stops working. And I wrote back to him. I wrote a long email, and some people got upset with me for writing this, but I said, do you really think these systems that you're applying are changing? Do you think that they're changing after you learn them? How could that happen? I said, the only thing that's changing is you. You get bored. You get frustrated. You have failure, and you forget about all your successes. I said, you're the problem. I didn't say it in a mean way. I said, but you're the problem. And the advantage of that is that you're also the solution. You simply have to recognize, and if you recognize that, you're going to be able to get past it. I was surprised. I thought, you know, he's just going to blow off NMT. But in fact, he didn't. He continued to work with NMT. And he wrote me an email. I had sent him, it was a couple of years later, I sent him an email and I said, hey, I'm just curious. It's been a long time since we talked. I'm just curious what you're doing. And he wrote me back. He said, you know what? I said, you were right. And he was using NMT. He was getting good results. The belief in the practitioner, it's critical. Again, you know, if you go to a dentist and you have a carry in your tooth, it doesn't matter what the dentist believes. It doesn't even matter what he thinks. If he's a professional and he's experienced, he can be thinking about the vacation he's going to begin tomorrow, you know, going to Hawaii or whatever, while he's filling your tooth and still do a great job. He doesn't have to be present at all, except physically. His mind can be anywhere. That's not true of this work. What you believe and where you're at, you know, the fact that your fanny is sitting on the chair in front of the client doesn't have a lot to do with it. It's where your mind is at. In fact, most of my work is remote. My fanny is almost never on a chair in front of the client that I'm working with. But I have to be present. If I'm going to get results, I have to be there. And in work that occurs not in a physical domain, but in the domain of mind, that's absolutely paramount. And the third thing, which is very, very important, is the structure and content of the particular method. And I think that's where NMT shines. You can get lucky in healing. Mr. Wright, for a period of time, got lucky. Then he got tragically unlucky. But what we're trying to do is skew that luck so that we go as close to 100% as possible in our responses. All medicine, all energetic medicine systems are metaphorical models. They're ways of applying intention to change the awareness and belief and seeing of possibility within the client. Every single one of them. And it doesn't matter whether the people that are doing the system or teaching the system know that or not. And a lot of them don't know that. They think they're doing something else. And we're going to talk about that for a minute. Therapeutic intention is part of any energetic medicine intervention. And there are a lot of methods in which the method is taught as a causal and mechanistic intervention. And it's not true. All are metaphorical models. Intention is structured in the practitioner's mind and then delivered to the patient. In my practice, in my profession, rather, many times low-force systems are used, so that the old model that people may have in their minds of chiropractors applying large, rapid forces and creating what's called a cavitation that causes this popping of a joint are not necessary in these systems. This is an activator, and an activator is a spring-loaded device. It can be set at different levels of intensity. And arguably, it doesn't move bones. It may introduce some force, and that force may cause some neurological stimulation of mechanoreceptors. But in the end, it's a change of awareness that is occurring. A bigger part of it, though, is that the whole system of activator adjusting is based upon the application of intention. You have a client laying face down. You may stroke this area or this area, look for a reflection or change in leg length to reveal the body's response to that stimulation. In other words, you're asking the body, is there a problem here? Is there a problem here? If there is a problem here, shorten a leg to show me that. That's what it's about. That's what it's about, but it's not taught that way. It's taught as if it were a neurological reflex. I met Arlen Fuhr. He's the fellow that developed it when I presented at American Chiropractic, had a World Chiropractic Congress in Panama. It was about 6 years ago. So the presenters were invited to a cocktail party the night before, which doesn't seem like a terribly good idea before people present, but anyway, that's what they did. And so I was introduced to Arlen Fuhr, and I said, Dr. Fuhr, it's so good to meet you. I said, I'm Les Feinberg. I teach something called NMT that I developed, and I think that, you know, we'd have an interesting conversation, because as I see it, your work has a lot to do with intention, and it's a model for applying healing intention, and my work is different, but it's also a method of applying healing intention. And he looked at me like somebody, you know, like if somebody looks at you and your zipper's open or something. He gave me one of those looks, and then he moved to the opposite end of the party, and I never saw him for the rest of the night. If I went over here, he went over there. It was kind of interesting. Again, the idea that we're working in a mind domain is something that is quite offensive to people who feel otherwise. HIO, upper cervical. Some of the best results in chiropractic happen in upper cervical practices. In upper cervical practices, if you're not familiar, they typically do limit their adjusting only to the atlas. The atlas being the very top cervical vertebrae, it's like a ring. It's a ring that goes around the spinal cord. And the spinal cord, of course, is that highway that all the information is distributed to the whole of the body. So often the force that they use is they'll take a contact like this, a person will be laying with the side up, but it's not a force, it's like a vibration. It's like a sort of a vibration. And yet these guys get fantastic results. Because of a physical change that they produce? I don't think so. I think they have a beautiful metaphorical model. Here is the key. Here is the window to innate intelligence. And we're going to optimize that window. We're going to get rid of the interference that occurs at that window. It's great. It's beautiful. But most of the people who do the work don't understand that. They see it as a mechanistic model. They do like 8 x-rays, orthogonal x-rays. They don't understand. Maybe that's why I've never been invited to a chiropractic college. There are many systems based on these radionic vials, many systems of healing based on those. TBM, which I studied with Viktor Frank, a brilliant guy. NAET, Devi Nambudrapad, Biosat, Ellen Cutler, went to school with Ellen. JMT, others, many of the applied kinesiology folks use vials. And these vials are supposed to be prepared in a way that the water or other medium inside the vial is charged with an energy that causes the substance now to have the same properties as the thing that, whatever's on the label. And the way the system is used is typically this. You muscle test. You have a variety of these vials. Maybe there are different allergens or foods or there are organs or tissues. And you test and you find the one by muscle testing that seems to be indicated for that client and their problem. And then you have them hold it. And while they hold it, you'll do some kind of stimulation. You'll tap on their spine in certain places. You'll rub certain acupuncture points. Maybe you'll stick needles in certain acupuncture spots. So I practiced these methods for maybe 15 years. And I can tell you that we had good results some of the time, not all of the time. And I can tell you that when we had good results, sometimes it took dozens of sessions. So I got curious. And what I did one day is I had a chiropractor come to my office who was one of the most experienced kinesiologists that I've seen. And I also had an employee who was a really good muscle tester, testee, I should say. What I mean by that is that when you would muscle test this woman, if it was a strong test, you could just about do chin-ups on her arm. And if it was a weak test, it was like somebody had injected Botox and there was nothing there. It was a high contrast. You know, there was no, I wonder if that's a yes or no. You didn't have that kind of a problem with this woman. And what we did is we had 4 vials, and they represented, let's say, apple, peach, pear, and plum. And the idea was to test and to see if the client could identify which of the 4 vials it was by muscle testing if they weren't aware of what the vial was they were presented with. So we had these vials, and as you saw earlier, the vials are labeled with what they're supposed to represent. And so we had the chiropractor do the testing, and we did something like 40 trials. And what we saw was that 100% of the time, when the chiropractor knew what the vial was, made a selection himself, gave it to the client, muscle tested, that the client, not seeing the vial, was able to, by muscle testing, reveal what the vial was. Then I made a plain paper sheet and put an arbitrary mark, and we covered each one of them. I didn't even look when I put the sheets on, so I didn't know what the mark represented, and we didn't allow the chiropractor to learn anything about these by seeing even the mark. So he had to reach into a bag, grab the vial without looking, transfer it without looking, do the muscle test, apple, peach, pear, or plum. And what we found when we unblinded the test and looked at the results was that now the accuracy was 25%. 4 vials, 25% accurate, that's chance. That's all it is. Is it about the radionic vial? I don't think that it's about the radionic vial at all. It has nothing to do with it. It's about the awareness in the person who's doing the test, transferred by way of intention, even if that person doing the test doesn't know anything about intention and believes the vial to be what it's said to be, the intention still gets transferred. And what the client is responding to is the intention. When I realized that, I said, well, first of all, I said, gee, I've got about 2,000 vials here in my office. I could have bought a car with that money. They're about $5 a vial. So I learned something that was very important. Acupuncture. We talked a little bit about hole-in-one, this upper cervical in chiropractic, what a great model it is. You know, Chinese medicine is based upon a great model. It's based on this model that there is, in fact, this universal energy, and that this energy, this qi, or in Ayurvedic medicine, this prana, enters the body. It becomes differentiated into different properties, five elements. And those five elements have qualities. They have, there is an informational component to them as well as an energetic component to them, and they're distributed. They're distributed through channels. They're held in repositories. The channels are called meridians. The fine channels are called nadis. And the reservoirs are called chakras. It's a beautiful model, isn't it? It's a beautiful model for how the whole informs the particular. The whole of the universe informs the individual. And so this is a model that acupuncturists use. And it's interesting, you know, acupuncture began with needles. But then you can use Teixin needles that are non-piercing. You can use acupressure. So apparently it doesn't have to do with the needles. You can do it electrically. Well, wait a minute, what's it all about then? If it's not about the needles, you can do it all these different ways, what is it really about? There's some things like the rotation of needles. When needles are inserted, you know, it's kind of like, remember that movie Spinal Tap where they had the, the amplifier that went to 11? It's kind of like when you put these needles in, you have a dial, a rheostat that you can dial up or down. You can go clockwise to increase energy, counterclockwise to decrease energy. What sensors are there in the tissues that can read the rotation of a needle that is nanometers across? These things are as fine as a human hair. How does the tissue read that? How does it know that you're going clockwise or counterclockwise? Of course it doesn't. It's about intention. I've had acupuncturists walk out at this point of the presentation. Get up, walk, take a note, so like, oh, this is brilliant, this is wonderful. And I get to this point and they go, jackass, and out the door. Visceral manipulation. Jean-Pierre Barral is a famous guy, French fellow. He's an osteopath. He's written 4, 5, 6 books. I have 3 of them. On visceral manipulation. He's not the first one to do visceral manipulation. He's certainly the most scholarly, and he's done the best job of describing the movement of the organs, what can happen when they're restricted, when they're adhesions. And his theory is based upon the idea that many problems ensue as a result of these adhesions or restrictions in the normal movement within an organ and between organs in the body. And he's described this and methods of applying this. The thing is, if you watch him work and you read how he works, it doesn't match up with the anatomy of the body, because he uses relatively small forces, really a matter of a couple pounds or ounces. Well, if you know much about the anatomy of the body, you know that you have the skin. You have 3 layers of fascia underneath that. You have a layer of fat. You have several layers of muscle, at least 3 in the abdomen. Depending on the area, you may have more. Underneath that, you have the peritoneum. Within that, you have a big bag full of slippery fluid and a bunch of organs. Now, somebody explained to me how, when you put ounces of pressure on the body and you do these motions in the direction of physiological movement of the organs, how you transfer enough shear stress to tear apart an adhesion. I don't know. I did gross anatomy for 6 months in chiropractic college, and I don't see how it can happen. That's not a criticism of what he does, because it's very effective work. The point is, let's be clear. And if we can be clear, we have a lot more opportunity to help people than if we're basing our work on fantasies. I had an interesting experience. My partner is a woman in Mexico City. She's a psychologist and NMT practitioner. And there was a young man who was visiting Mexico City from Spain, who had studied with Bernal, who was friends with him. And I told him, I said, Ferran, I don't see this as mechanistic work. And he says, oh, no, no, he says it's not. He says it's not. He'll tell you that. He won't tell you that in his books, but he'll tell you that. So good for him. I'm glad he does. Craniosacral therapy, John Upledger. Another brilliant guy. He's done a lot of great work. There are a lot of people that do craniosacral therapy. And the thing is, if you look at it, the theory makes sense, but the application of the theory doesn't make sense, in the sense that these forces that are used are so subtle and so gentle that it's very difficult to imagine that they actually affect change by way of a physical process. The process that unfolds is an important process. This movement of cerebrospinal fluid, the release of fixation within the spine, the restoration of normal movement in the cranium and the spine is fundamental. But I will tell you that what happens in craniosacral therapy happens as a result of the application of intention through a metaphorical model. We actually have a craniosacral therapy pathway. It's part of a bigger pathway called the body frame and organ structural optimization pathway that includes this work and Bernal's work. We get immediate results, and we get results that people who've had this work done say are every bit as effective as having the work physically performed. Shamanism, probably the oldest of energetic medicine, and effective work. There isn't a culture in the world that doesn't have shamanism. They have their own homegrown shamanism. If you go to Germany, you'll find the bone setters. If you go to the Ukraine, if you go to the Inuit people, I think these are from Inuit people, at least one of them. You go to Asia, you go to Africa, and you'll find such wisdom. A friend of mine, Kamal Kokai, who's MD in New York City and quite a well-known fellow, went to Africa to learn something about his roots in healing there. And what he told me is that he learned that one of the stories of the particular tribe that he was staying with was how life began. And it began with the descending from the heavens of a double helix. And I went, whoa, whoa, too much. Shamanism, I've studied with shamans from Colombia and Brazil. I've been to many healing ceremonies with them. Found them to be really brilliant people. And as I listen to the songs, which I understand only part of because they're in Spanish, what I hear is that there's songs that talk about cleansing, about healing, about restoration, about restoring contact with, in this case, Christ, because these are folks from Catholic countries. And so what I'm seeing is that, again, even things like the invocation of a spirit animal is a metaphorical model, you know? Maybe you have somebody come in who's depressed and anxious. Maybe they need a little bit of puma in them, right? So, but what about Western medicine? What about pharmaceuticals as shamanism? Irving Kirsch is a psychologist at the University of Connecticut, and he believes that the effectiveness of Prozac and similar drugs may be attributed almost entirely to placebo effect. He and Guy Saperstein analyzed 19 clinical trials of antidepressants. His view, based on their research, was that it accounted for 75% of the drug's effectiveness. Bruce Lipton, in his book, Biology of Belief, says that The published studies show it's about 80% for Prozac, but the unpublished studies that were released as a result of Freedom of Information Act, because some of the research was government funded, show there's 100%. 100%. And he explains that it's a particularly good placebo because it gives you kind of a buzzy sensation in the head, apparently, when you take it. And so the body's going, wow, this must be the good stuff. Something must be happening because I feel buzzy. Other studies, 39 studies analyzed by Saperstein, done between 1974 and 1995 with depressed patients treated with drugs, psychotherapy or a combination of both, in that study he found that 50% of the drug effect is due to placebo. That's a long story, but it's well documented. So, as they say, Google it. You know, that's actually one of the nice things about the availability of information these days. And one of the things that'll supplement, it's a good time to mention, supplement your work here. If you're working with a client and you're working with a pathway and you find that there's something, you know, I'm not entirely clear about this, you Google it. And all of a sudden, you have access to world-class information instantly. You don't have to go out and go shopping for textbooks in neurology. Anything that you're not clear on, you know, Wikipedia has good information. Universities often have fantastic information available. And it's quick, it's easy, and there's no reason why you can't supplement the information that you need and don't have as you go along, painlessly. Painlessly. So, also, we're going to be talking as we go along a little bit further here in this presentation about different books, different researchers, and again, you can listen to these people on YouTube speaking about the subjects that they're talking about, and you can get a lot of information very quickly and very easily that way. All of the things that we've talked about have one thing in common, and that is they're all about the delivery of intention. That intention is structured. It's structured according to the metaphorical model that the practitioner using the system is trained in, and it becomes a way for them to model and give content and shape to their intention. Without that, it's as if someone comes into your office ill, and you say, put your arm around them, that'll help. I really hope you get better. And pay the receptionist on your way out. That's not enough. We have to do more than that. So, why don't we just dispense with all this stuff? Why don't we dispense with all the things that are unnecessary? And if it's really about intention and how you structure intention, let's go there. That's where the power is. And that's what occurred to me about 12 years ago. And why don't we create a system of therapeutic intention based on the most powerful metaphorical model that we have? And what is that? It's language. Language is the most powerful metaphorical model that we have to represent that meaning and significance. Gertrude Stein. You know who Gertrude Stein is, the writer, and she may be best known for the one statement, there's no there, there, which I didn't realize until I thought, what a great statement for me to include. And I looked it up, and she was actually talking about returning to her childhood home in Oakland, and apparently the house was gone, and she said, there's no there, there. But it's such a great statement, it gets used in many different ways. We're going to be talking about a model of the universe that is exactly that. There is no there there. There is no there there in the way that we perceive it. There is no material substrate to the universe that you're in. Which means, by the way, get ready, there is no material substrate to you. This fellow, have you ever heard of Bill Tiller, William Tiller? Tiller's a researcher, he's actually retired, which is really too bad because some of the research he's done has really been profound. He's not a researcher in airy-fairy stuff, you know, woo-woo. He's a real scientist. He's a material scientist, and, you know, not at some online university. This is Stanford. This is one of the best universities in the world. He's published perhaps 1,000 or more research papers, peer-reviewed in physics journals over the course of his career. And he's written a number of books. One of those is called Conscious Acts of Creation. And in this, he studies not only the application of intention to clients, to subjects, to people, because it's fairly easy to imagine how the application of intention, if it could be received by another person, could influence that person. He applies intention to physical systems. Physical systems. So here's the research that he reports. One is a study where trained meditators were asked to use specific intention to influence physical systems. And the first of those was purified water in equilibrium with the air, temperature equilibrium with the air. And the idea there was to change the pH, change the acid base. The second, the liver enzyme alkaline phosphatase, to change the biological activity of that in vitro. The third, the coenzyme nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide, NAD, to change its physiological activity in vitro. The fourth was the main cell energy molecule, ATP, to change its activity. And the fifth was to change the development of fruit fly larvae, simply by intention. And here's the results. In number one, there was a shift in pH in the purified water simply as a result of the intention of the meditators, delivered by way of an IIED, intention-embedded electronic device. He actually uses like a quartz resonator, and the practitioner, the meditator, focuses the intention in that device, and then they put it in. He believes that. We're going to talk about a model of the universe in which the device is actually made of the same stuff as the intention. So, anyway, let's go on. There was a total swing in the hydrogen ion content concentration of 100. Statistically, this was a signal size in terms of statistical relevance, 100 times our measurement accuracy, with a very robust effect, greater than 10,000. So changing the pH of water, that's by intention, that's amazing. Number two to number four, we were talking about these different enzymes and their physiological activity in vitro. An increase in thermodynamic activity of in vitro ALP, NAD, and ATP by a very significant amount. Effect sizes were 10 to 25 at statistical significance of P, that is, chance being less than 0.001. So these are amazing things that were documented. Intention is something that changes reality. It changes reality. How can it change reality? And number five, a reduction in vivo larval development time, the adult fly state, by 15 to 25%. 15 to 25%. How many of you have kids? Huh? So how does this sound? Instead of 9 months pregnant, we'll make it 7 months? Huh? Hands? That's what I thought. It's amazing. So as an NMT practitioner, what we do is we apply specific intention relative to the NMT client, a la Tiller's experiments. There's something particular about the experiment. You notice that when the intention was to change the pH of the water didn't turn blue. It didn't turn red. it didn't get cherry flavored. The pH changed because that was the intention. I don't know if you imply intention to make water cherry flavored if it works, but the point is that intention must be specific to be powerful. It must be specific to be powerful because the intention is what describes, what creates the reality out of the potential reality that exists. And we'll talk more about this because it's really one of the most profound things that's been learned in the last 100 years. It's been learned in the last 100 years in science, but it's maybe one of the most profound things that humans have ever become aware of. The NMT practitioner uses the therapeutic dialogue, the NMT therapeutic dialogue, to structure intention to direct transformation within the client and induces within the client awareness of the opportunity to transform the mind-body. But it isn't a one-way street. It isn't a one-way street. Let me ask you this. When do you suppose the dialogue begins between you and the client? When do you suppose? Do you think it's when you put your hand on the client and you start muscle testing? When do you suppose? Earlier or later? Yeah. As soon as the idea comes into your mind to begin interacting with that person, it's begun. It's on. So NMT recruits both the intention of the practitioner and that of the client to manifest a transformation. And you'll see that as we talk about our model of the universe, you'll see that the independent and separate you and the independent and separate client come together in kind of a syncytium of consciousness and then release. Come together, come apart, transfer information, and release. So NMT creates the opportunity for more accurate awareness of the conditions within the body, the external challenges it must adapt to, and the unrealized innate potential to adapt and to heal. This is John Archibald Wheeler. You know, there was the young, handsome Elvis stamp that the Postal Service had and the fat old Elvis. And this is the young John Archibald Wheeler and the old John Archibald. But actually, he looks pretty good in both of those pictures. He unfortunately passed away a few years ago at the age of, I think, 92. Probably one of the most productive quantum physicists that lived in the 20th century. He was involved in the Manhattan Project. You know, quantum physics is an area where you're pretty much done. You turn 30, you know, your juice is been squeezed out of you, and you're all dried up. This guy was doing important work and still publishing at the time of his death. He was still doing important work in his 70s. Brilliant, brilliant guy. Here's what he says about the nature of the world. He says, if the views that we're exploring are correct, one principle, observer participancy. Observer, what does that mean? I'm the observer, but I'm not the observer. I'm the observer and the participant, and I can't get out of that loop. There is no, there's nothing to step off to. That's where we are. We're all observer participants. Suffices to build everything. What does he mean by that? Everything. Everything is pretty all-inclusive, isn't it? I mean, it's like everything. He says the picture of the participatory universe will flounder and have to be rejected if it cannot account for the building of the laws of the universe he's talking about, and space-time as part of the law. And here's the kicker, an out-of-law substance. Out of law, substance, out of a concept, substance? It has no other than a higgledy-piggledy way to build law out of statistics of billions upon billions of observer participancy. In other words, that the universe has self-organized. It's almost like the way you get dressed in the morning. You know, you look in the mirror, you go, oh, I think I'll wear this, and this little hat, you know. How's that? No, different color. Okay, and yeah, and that's the way the universe happened. But it didn't happen, it's happening. Because you know what? The universe is different at this moment than it was when I started my sentence. Oh, and it just changed again. Here's another comment by Wheeler. He says, no, it's not in that sense I'm talking about logic. I'm talking about logic in the sense of the nuts and bolts, if you will, of which the universe is made. Just as Einstein and Clifford were talking about geometry as the magic building material out of which the world was made. Everything's made of logic. Everything's made of logic. And logic exists in one domain, the only domain that exists. It's the domain of mind. Nothing exists outside of the domain of mind. I have the same experience you do every day. Don't get me wrong. You know, you got in a plane to come here, you drove here, I had to drive for 3 hours down the highway, and it's a physical experience, you know. I shoved bacon and eggs down my throat a couple hours ago, washed it down with some coffee. But it all occurred in a domain of mind. It feels like it has a different essence or a different fundamental basis because of the logic of the way that information and that experience is organized. That's why it feels that way. That behaves in a certain way, and yet it's in a domain of mind. Sorry, I have to make a call. This is really important. So, all of you have these. That's right. Make sure your ringer is off. Oh, mine's off. If your long-gone great-great-grandfather got a pass from heaven, could come back for a day, and you wanted to show him your new iPhone or Samsung, you could do that. But he might have a misunderstanding. Because if you showed him and you went like this and you said, look, I have all my friends are on this list and I can just scroll through that, he'd go, wow, that's really cool. And you would think that he understood the same thing that you understood. But really, what he'd be thinking is, what a neat machine. Inside of there is a paper roll, and there's some weights to create momentum, and, you know, some flywheel kind of a thing, and somehow she's able to get traction on that glass and make it move. What a clever idea. Wonder what else you can do with that. We know the difference. The difference is that there is a system of logic that has been programmed into the chip in this phone that simulates this physical reality that Grandpa would have thought of, because he's seen lots of lists on paper. In fact, that's about the only thing that lists were made on when he was a kid. But now he sees a metaphorical model of that. And this gives you a way of kind of thinking about this transition in our minds from informational reality to physical reality. It's a matter of logic, and that's what Wheeler was talking about when he talks about the universe being created out of logic. The fact that it feels physical is simply a matter of misinterpretation. Not everybody has that misinterpretation. Some people have been real incisive. You know, if you ask the Buddha, hey, you think this is physical reality is real? and say no. That's why they do those sand paintings and then they mess them all up. If you ask Jesus Christ, if you ask Muhammad, I think they'd tell you that they have a different understanding. But for most of us in the cultures that we come from that reinforce that materialistic model, we have a different way of looking at things. Well, we had a different way of looking at things. Now we're going to change that way of looking at things. Wheeler also said that his career has gone in three phases, because when he began his work as a quantum physicist, it was all about particles. Then it was all about fields. And he says now it's all about information. So, big things are made of little things. Do you believe it? Big things are made of little things. Seems obvious. How could you not believe that? As it turns out, about 1900, physics believed that it had come to the end of the road. In fact, Lord Kelvin, known for the Kelvin scale and for measuring absolute temperature, advised young men at the turn of the century not to go in physics because it was like a dead field. And I was like, party's over, guys. You know, why don't you go into something else, like, you know, telegraphs or something. And of course, he didn't have to tell women that because there weren't any women in physics then. So it was a different time. All of a sudden, things changed. There was a crack in the cosmic egg and everything exploded. The whole view of the world exploded. Everything changed, went upside down. And this was the photoelectric effect. It was the only thing that Newtonian physics hadn't described, the photoelectric effect. What happens, what causes your, when you take a picture on film, when you take a picture on film, what causes the silver to change? That's a photoelectric effect. It's the only thing that hadn't been described. And the whole theory of Newtonian physics unraveled based upon that discovery. And what we're left with is the idea that all its are patterns of bits. Bits of information. All its are bits. And this is a model. This isn't actually what particles look like with zeros and ones, but it's a model. It's a metaphorical model. There's a ball, and that ball represents a particle, and the particle, as you see here, has zeros and ones populating the little squares. The point is that every particle is made of information. What makes one different than another? What makes an electron different than a proton, different than a boson, is the logic of its organization. How come we can't see that? How come we can't see that in every day? Well, this is a graph of radioactive decay. You know, if I had a pound of plutonium sitting here, well, first of all, we'd all be in big trouble. But if I did, we could say with absolute certainty how long it would take for half of that plutonium to decay, for it to radioactively decay, down to the second, down to the nanosecond. But the interesting thing is, if we took one molecule, one atom of plutonium, and we looked at it, we have no way of knowing if that atom is the first of the many atoms in half of this that decays over its half-life, or if it's the last one to decay millions of years from now. Because, you know, half of a half of a half of a half, you never get there. We don't know. It's a matter of chance and probability. And why the macro world looks materialistic is because we're looking at a big system. The tiniest thing that you can look at is enormously complex at a quantum level. So if you look at a photograph of a crowd of 100,000 people, how much do you know about any particular person? Not much. And that's the reason that the macro world looks the way it looks. active information. David Bohm was a fantastic guy, one of my favorite authors. He was a quantum physicist. He too passed away fairly recently in the 90s. Studied all kinds of things. After his career as a quantum physicist, he became one of the many quantum physicists whose later years were spent writing and thinking about the philosophy and the cosmology of quantum physics. Okay, we've already discovered that, you know, you do this to, you know, make atomic fusion happen, that particles behave in this way when you bombard them with certain other particles. But what does all this stuff mean? If that's really the way the world works, then what does it mean? What does it mean about ourselves and our possibilities? And so Bohm is one of the people that has done some of the most creative and interesting writing in that area. He described a term called active information, and active information is this. You know, you think of information, well, piece of information, I'll look up a name or a telephone number in a phone book or something. There's information, and that's what it is. It is what it is. And active information, though, was something different. It was like a dynamic information. And it was this idea that the universe is a field, an informational field of infinite potential. Nothing set, nothing created except what you intend to see. He talked about particle physics, you know, and this building of particle accelerators. You know, they make bigger and bigger and bigger, and they've got this new Hadron Collider in Europe, and, you know, they're talking about building an even bigger one. And he said, this will go on forever. It'll go on forever because the act of choosing to observe at this level causes reality to manifest itself at this level. So as long as you've got the money to keep building these bigger and bigger things, instruments, that's what they are. They're like, in a sense, they're like a magnifying glass, only it's a big electronic thing. As long as you've got the money to do it, you'll keep finding smaller and smaller things ad infinitum. So get out your checkbook. Isolated materials, according to Niels Bohr, the father of quantum physics, are abstractions. Isolated particles are abstractions. Their properties are definable and observable only through their interaction with other systems. Nothing in this universe is separate from anything else. Nothing is separate from anything else. Distinct, defined, yes. Separate, no. We find what we're looking for. That's the bottom line. We find what we're looking for. So be careful what you look for. There is no... Oh, this is a scary font, isn't it? This is one of those Halloween fonts. No objective external reality. And there isn't. But you know what? It's not scary. It's an opportunity. What's this? Looks like little blobs of color. What's this? Oh, it looks like a guy in a jacket with a tie. It looks like a bow tie. He's got a mustache, hair. Looks happy. All kinds of things that we see. Max Planck was the physicist who developed the idea of quanta, indivisible units of energy, light, electrical energy, and it's interesting that this picture by Seurat, called La Parade, was in 1880. It was a generation prior to science, and this happens. Art sometimes precedes science, and the reason that I wanted you to see that was to make a point. Have you ever seen this picture? It's kind of a famous optical illusion. I'm sure most of you have seen it. And sometimes when you first look at it, all you see is either an old woman or you see a young woman, and until somebody points it out to you, you can't see the other choice. And in fact, sometimes once you're looking and you see one choice, you can't make yourself see the other choice. And then pretty soon, if you study it for a while, you'll realize that All you have to do is make a little shift inside your head. I don't mean turning your, I mean perceptually. And she's young, she's old, she's young, she's old, she's young, she's old. And you can do it at will. Here's another one. Romantic interlude or very scary party. Again, it's a matter of interpretation. It's a matter of the meaning that you attach to the photons that reach your eye. Because those photons aren't changing. The only thing that's changing is the way you interpret them. And what is this? A guy with glasses or a liar? Well, it looks like it's both. So, there is no objective external reality. It's a matter, everything is subjective, and it's a matter of interpretation. This is John Stuart Bell. He was a physicist from Ireland. And, you know, there were problems in quantum physics. There were problems in quantum physics were based upon something that was predicted by quantum physics, and that is entanglement. Entanglement was a crazy thing. We're going to take a look at a little video about entanglement. Bell was a fellow that put all this to rest. What he actually did is he looked at all of the data, laboratory data from, this was 1964, so quantum physics goes back 30, 40 years. There's a lot of data. And what he did is he analyzed that data, and what he found was that the only way that data could be produced is if you discarded one assumption that we all have, and that is the assumption of locality, that there actually is a difference between this point in space and this point in space. It seems obvious as can be. Einstein believed it. Everybody believed it. Until Bell said, you fellas have made a mistake. And the mistake you've made is assuming that space is real. That was your first mistake. Nick Herbert is the authority on Bell's theorem, non-locality. And this was a number of years ago. You're going to see how many years ago in a little while. This was a presentation. This was an interview done with Jeffrey Mishlove on a program that was called Thinking Aloud. It was a wonderful program.
I wonder if we can begin the program tonight by having you explain to our viewers just what is quantum physics and why would you find the phenomenon of consciousness to be so interesting?
Well, quantum physics started out in the 20s to explain the interaction of light with atoms. That was it focused on that. But now it's extended to explain the interaction of anything with anything. It's basically physicists' theory of the world these days. And it's been very successful. There are two reasons, I think, why quantum physics and consciousness have some connection. One is that quantum theory, as most people know by now, is very strange. It has very weird properties. And
you're dealing with the very smallest particles of matter that exist.
Yes, that's true.
Subatomic particles. And physicists, typically we hear that this sort of stuff is no longer solid. It's mostly a vacuum in quantum physics.
Not only is it not solid, is it mostly empty space, but it's also probabilities. Just fuzzy, not even totally real.
In other words, particles aren't even particles anymore.
Particles aren't even particles anymore. And that's one of the connections with consciousness, that the solidity of matter is dissolving away in the light of these theories and becoming more and more like the fuzziness that's inside our heads.
And that's the basic, most fundamental theory in all of physics.
That's the basis of everything that we do in physics anyway.
And physics is, in effect, the basic science of all the sciences.
Right.
So in the sense, the most fundamental theory of all of science is that the basis of reality is fuzzy.
It's fuzzy. It's crumbling and is ambiguous. That's the word I like to use. Mm-hmm. That somehow there's a basic ambiguity at the center of the world. mm-hmm. The center of the inanimate world, just the unconscious world. And so that's the first reason, that there are some formal resemblances between quantum theory and what the mind looks like from the inside.
Mm-hmm.
And the second reason is that physicists are running out of problems. In some senses, we're too successful.
Mm-hmm.
All the problems that are within our grasp, we've not solved entirely, but solved in principle. So we're reaching for more and more things to capture within this net.
Mm-hmm.
People are now trying to explain the very creation event itself by using quantum physics.
Mm-hmm.
And we've just about run the particle trip down to the limit. Now it's only a matter of money. bigger and bigger accelerators, that's the way to go.
Mm-hmm.
But that can only go on so long. So many physicists are looking for new questions to ask. And
the term that I keep hearing is quantum interconnectedness, and the notion that separability doesn't exist, that somehow all is one, the way the mystics used to say
yes.
it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there is a peculiar feature in quantum theory
mm-hmm.
called quantum interconnectedness, and it was discovered right when quantum theory was discovered. It was found that in the quantum description of two objects, when two objects briefly interact, and then you pull them apart, in the description at least, they never come apart. There's a kind of stickiness that connects them together, so they're bound together forever in the theory. They
mm-hmm.
never separate, even though they're not interacting anymore. And it was thought that this was just a theoretical artifact. It was nothing that existed in the real world. And physicists noted it, said this is very strange, and then they promptly forgot about it for about 50 years. But recently, due to something called Bell's theorem, new interest has been rekindled in this interconnectedness. Bell's theorem proves that this connection is not a theoretical artifact, but actually exists in the real world.
I should mention, for the benefit of our viewers, Nick, that you are probably one of the world's foremost authorities on Bell's theorem.
Yes.
That's what you specialized in. And Bell's theorem seems like the crack in the cosmic egg, in a way. It's the one part of quantum physics that's almost turned everything upside down.
Yeah, one of my claims to fame is that I have produced the shortest proof of Bell's theorem in existence. It's about three lines.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
Bell's theorem, as I understand it, goes back even prior to Bell to Einstein and Einstein's disagreement with quantum physics back in the early days. He made his classic statement, God doesn't play dice with
yes.
the universe, at a time when Einstein himself felt he disagreed with quantum physics, as I understand it, and he felt that if quantum physics were true, it would have these horrendous implications, which now turns out are true.
Yes. Einstein was never comfortable with quantum theory, and he basically had three gripes with it, if I can.
Yeah.
The one gripe was that quantum theory is a probabilistic theory.
Mm-hmm.
It just describes things like the world is essentially random and governed only by general laws that just give the odds for things to happen, but within these odds, anything can happen,
mm-hmm.
that God plays dice. Einstein didn't like that, but he could have lived with that. The second aspect that Einstein didn't like was the thinglessness of quantum, this fuzzy ambiguity,
mm-hmm.
that the world isn't made of things. It's not made of objects like, it was put by Paul Davies, the notion that somehow big things are made of little things. Quantum theory doesn't describe the world that way.
Oh.
Big things aren't made of little things. They're made of entities whose attributes aren't there when you don't look, but become there when you do look. Now that sounds, it's very, very strange.
Like an illusion. Or Hindu concept of Maya.
That's right.
It is
the world exists when we don't look at it in some strange state that is indescribable.
Mm-hmm.
And then when we look at it, it becomes absolutely ordinary.
Mm-hmm.
It's like as though someone were trying to pull something over our eyes.
Uh-huh.
The world is an illusion. Einstein didn't like that. He felt that the big things are made of little things.
Yeah.
As the classical physicist
thought. The Newtonian view of billiard
yes.
ball-like particles, that if
yes.
you could only understand the momentum and position of each one, you could predict everything in the universe, yes.
Comfortable sort of...
You mentioned three things that Einstein objected to, then there must be one more.
Well, the third thing is this interconnectedness.
Uh-huh.
Einstein said, the world cannot be like this, because this interconnectedness goes faster than light. Mm-hmm. When this quantum connectedness, two objects could come together, meet, and then go to each end of the universe, and they would still be connected instantly. Instantaneously, one would know what the fate of the other one was. Mm-hmm. Einstein said, now that could never be. Things can't, that's like voodoo. In fact, he used the word, it's like telepathy, he said.
Uh-huh.
He said, it's spooky, it's ghost-like. Almost his last words in his biography were, on this I absolutely stand firm. The world is not like this.
Anybody can be wrong, even Einstein. Well, he wouldn't like NMT because it's all about telepathy. That's what it is. That's what we're doing. So there's Nick and I last year outside the Boulder Creek Brewery talking quantum physics and drinking beer. He's a great guy. I really enjoyed meeting him. Wanted to do that for a long time. Had an opportunity to do that. And did. This takes 1 minute, and then we'll take our break, okay?
Then entanglement crushes our experience of space. Two objects, two electrons created together, are entangled. Send one to the other side of the universe. Now, do something to one, and the other responds instantly. Instantly. So, either information is traveling infinitely fast, or in reality, they are still connected. They are entangled. And since everything was entangled at the moment of the Big Bang, that means everything is still touching. Space is just the construct that gives the illusion that there are separate objects. Are we far enough down the rabbit hole yet?
One of the things that you'll see, even as you talk to quantum physicists, and certainly as you talk to people in energetic medicine, who are aware of these some of these things that we've been discussing, is that even though for a moment, while focused on these concepts, they can be congruent with them, the fact is that we're in a materialistic world. Even our language is materialistic. The whole vocabulary of our language is embedded with meaning that carries these ideas of separation, materialism, causality, time, space. All of the imagery, all of the iconography around us, all of the people we interact with, except other NMT practitioners perhaps, all of that, you know, it's kind of like, you know, crabs in a crab pot. You know, one is trying to get out, get some freedom, and the other crabs keep pulling them back down. And it's kind of like that. We have to be very careful because these materialistic, causal, deterministic models are hidden everywhere, booby-trapped everywhere. My good friend Jeff Ames and I often talk about things that we read at Vita Philosophy, other things about enlightenment, you know, trying to get a picture of the way things really are. And he says, hey, so you think you can ever really get enlightened? And I said, yeah, but I said, you know what it's like? I think it's like being in the middle of an ocean and treading water. And about the time that you get your eyes and nose up above water and you can catch a breath, you kind of go back down again. And it's always a struggle to keep your head above water. I think it's like that. I think it's more like that. It's available, but you don't get it. You have to maintain it. And that's something we're going to have to be aware of throughout our practice of NMT, because we're going to find that even though a disease doesn't exist, just the way particles and matter don't exist in an absolute way, in an actual way. They're real. It's not a matter of real or unreal. It's a matter of whether reality conforms to your model of what actually is going on. And we're going to have to keep reminding ourselves, because we're going to have all of this static that is going to have a tendency to distort the way we look at things. So we're going to be working with people, and we're going to, well, we're doing NMT. I know my model of the universe, the what I am, what my client is, anything could happen here. You know, the universe allows for anything to occur. It's a matter of probabilities, and what we're all about is skewing probabilities in the direction we want things to go. And then all of a sudden we'll think that, oh yeah, they have strep infection. Well, that takes 3 weeks to get over, and da-da-da-da-da, right? So we have to be real careful that we don't allow into our minds these limiting concepts, because what we're doing occurs in a domain of mind, and in a domain of mind, what you're aware of and what you believe determine the outcome.